Time is probably the most controversial topic to discuss about. Hundreds of philosophers and scientists have tried to define it in very different ways, and each one of us could probably have his own view about it. Time doesn't seem to flow regularly. Have you ever waited for the end of a boring lesson which seemed to never come to an end? Or have you ever spent an entire day with your girlfriend thinking that only a few hours have passed? Is time just an illusion? Is it the same for everyone? Is there some scientific proof of its existence? Do you want to know the answer? Stick with me, and I'll tell you everything in a moment. Before trying to answer all these questions, let's think about this. What is time? Time is just a way of describing how an object changes compared to another one. Let me give you a pair of examples. What is a day? It's just a method to say that the Earth has completed a rotation around its axis. What is a year? It's a common way of telling that Earth has done a complete revolution around the Sun. This definition of time leads to some tricky and astonishing conclusions. As an example, on Venus, a day lasts longer than a year. Time has been a crucial element in the description of nature, and it has always been described as something immutable. As a matter of fact, Newton, one of the most brilliant scientists ever, talked about absolute space and absolute time. These assumptions were useful to create his theory of gravitation, which explains how planets orbit around the Sun and why everything falls to ground on Earth. When do we use time in physics? Always. One of the most common quantities in science is velocity, which describes how a position of something changes in time. A lot of other quantities, such as the energy of a moving object, are linked to velocity. Therefore, what we consider as a true scientific assumption sometimes turns out to be just a small approximation of a much larger theory. Is it true that time is non-variable and universal? Do we share the same time? All scientists at the end of the 19th century would have given a positive answer to this question, but they didn't know that a young Deutsch man studying in Zurich was going to prove them wrong, unraveling one of the most shocking discoveries in human history. Do you want to know his name? Albert Einstein. In 1905, the so-called Annus Mirabilis came out with four research papers containing the famous theory of special relativity and other studies on different subjects, particularly one regarding the photoelectric effect, led him to a Nobel Prize in 1921. What is this theory about? Let's start from the main principle that Isaac Newton and Galileo Galilei used to describe the world in a scientific way, the principle of relativity. Have you ever heard something about it? If not, don't worry, it's very simple. It states that laws of physics must remain the same in systems which differ from a constant velocity. As an example, if we carry two identical experiments, one in a laboratory and one moving at a fixed velocity on a bus, they must lead to the same results, and the form of physics laws is exactly the same in both the systems. This is the reason why when you are on a train in a station and you look from the window, you can't tell if you're moving or you're standing still while other trains are moving. By starting with such a common principle, Newton and Galilei elaborated in a way of composing velocities of two different systems. If a car moves at 40 miles per hour and a bus goes in the same direction at 60 miles per hour, the driver of the car has the perception of being stationary and seeing a bus moving at 20 miles per hour. On the other side, if two cars crash against each other at 30 miles per hour, the impact will be the same of a single car hitting a standing wall with a velocity of 60 miles per hour. Is this true for everything? No, there's a phenomenon which doesn't follow this simple rule. Light. In an empty space, light has a boundless velocity of 300,000 kilometers per hour. Therefore, at the end of the 19th century, physics were struggling to give an appropriate description of light because it seemed to maintain always the same speed, no matter the frame from which you watch it. Light velocity doesn't compose according to Galilei's rules. How could such a tremendous problem be solved? Einstein tried to elaborate a theory based both on the principle of relativity and on the absolute velocity of light, which is called as an invariant quantity. The consequences of these two statements reveal breathtaking aspects on the nature of time, which revolutionized our way of perceiving life. Before finding out more about this, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel, clicking the bell so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Einstein's assumptions brought two main consequences. Time is neither independent nor universal. Instead, it is strictly linked to the frame under which you see a phenomenon. More precisely, it depends on the velocity that the event has respectively to the observer. Let me say this in a simpler way. If we go at a high velocity, other people will see our time dilated. A famous case is the example of twins. If a couple of twins starts a chronometer on Earth and one of them flies at a light velocity around the Earth for 10 years, when he will return to Earth, the chronometer of the other twin will say that 30 or 40 years have passed. What an astonishing discovery. The one on Earth will have white hair and will be very old, while the other one will have remained pretty much the same. Time is not the same for everyone. It flows different for each one of us. The higher the velocity, the slower the flow of time will be. The consequences of this scientific discovery were very profound and even affected other cultural sectors. As a matter of fact, in the beginning of the 20th century, various artists and writers showed a sense of incommunicability and loneliness in their works. It seemed that each one of us had a different watch, flowing at his own rate, and nothing could be shared among different people. Think, for example, of the famous portrait, The Scream, of Munch. However, don't be too scared by that. An experiment similar to the previous one has been carried out in recent years, and at the velocities that we usually see, the difference in the flow of time is so small that our wristwatches cannot detect it. Nevertheless, time dilation is a major factor at bigger scales. As an example, all modern GPS satellites need to be set according to relativistic effects. Moreover, Einstein understood that time is linked to space, as he talked of a single element called space-time. When dealing with an event in physics, we must specify its three coordinates in space. But since time is different for each event, we must specify a fourth coordinate that gives us information about the time seen by the event. Furthermore, a second article was published by Einstein in 1915, unveiling one of the most complex modern scientific theories, general relativity. What does it say? How can we intuitively understand such an advanced model? Shortly, Einstein tried to apply his special relativity to gravitational phenomena, such as planets orbiting around the star or stars colliding at high velocities. He came out with an important result. Space and time are deformed by the mass of an object. What does it mean? Imagine the space-time continuum as a big cloth sheet. When a sphere with a mass, the Sun, is put on the center, the sheet curves. If another lighter object, the Earth, tries to go on a straight line through the sheet, it starts to move circularly around the first one as a result of the curvature of the sheet. How is time deformed by the mass of a star? Time is more dilated and slowed down when it's near the object. We can repeat the twin experiment just by making them live at different altitudes. The chronometer of the one at the lowest height will show a shorter time. However, these effects are so tiny that only very precise clocks can detect them. Want to know an extreme example of this phenomenon? There's a place in the universe where time stops. And no, it's not when you're kissing your loved one. Do you know where? Around a black hole, the densest object of the universe. In these areas, gravity is so strong that even light rays don't manage to escape. Such a high mass deforms space-time, so much that time stops. What we thought of time has been destroyed by these theories. Is there something left? Yes. In the universe, things tend to move in a special time direction. Have you ever seen a broken glass returning intact on a table? A broken egg recomprising itself? Surely not. Physics say that these events are irreversible. As an example, take a hot pot with your hands. What you can see is that heat moves from the pot to your hand, warming you. A flow in the opposite direction with your hand getting colder and colder is just absurd. This simple example shows the second law of thermodynamics, which states that heat moves from hotter to colder objects. This law can be formulated even in a more rigorous form. Entropy increases with time. So what is entropy? It's a quantity that measures the disorder of a system. If a system has more ways to reach its configuration, it has a greater entropy. A shuffled deck of cards has a greater entropy than an ordered one. According to this law, everything seems to have a precise way to evolve in time. We can think that time is not just an illusion of our mind, but something that is linked to physical phenomenon. Therefore, a theoretical discovery in the middle of the 20th century has furnished another proof that time is not necessary. In the 60s, two famous physicists, Bryce DeWitt and John Wheeler, were trying to uniform general relativity with quantum mechanics, another great theory which works almost perfectly in describing atoms and particles. These two models are in contrast with each other, and physicists are struggling to solve this tremendous problem. However, DeWitt and Wheeler came up with an equation that partially uniformed the theories. The breathtaking characteristics of this law is that it doesn't involve time. It doesn't depend on velocities or other quantities linked to time. From a physical point of view, time is not necessary, hence, it doesn't have to exist. As we have seen, time is very different from what we can think. Science has broken our certainties step by step, coming to the conclusion that time might not be useful when dealing with infinitely big or infinitely small events. But finally, what is time? Time is a convenient way of describing the world in which we live. Think about this example. On Earth, we used to say up and under because it's faster to say that the second floor is under the third. But if we move in space on a little rocket, how can we say what is up and what is under? That linguistic convention is totally useless in space. The same happens with time. On Earth, it's surely easier to imagine that everything moves in a universal time rather than saying that an object moves respectively to another. But when dealing with small-scale events involving particles or great explosion of immense stars, time is totally not necessary. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find this topic exciting? Are you amazed by the dilation of time? Are you afraid by discovering that time might just be an illusion? Is there anything more you want to hear about time? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.